Those bonds will make it easier for Mayor Keller to move forward on his agenda, but Tuesday's results created a different hurdle for the returning mayor. Power has shifted in city council, with Democratic incumbents in districts 1 and 5 losing their seats to conservative challengers, and with seats in districts 7 and 9 headed to a runoff. The council could move to the right ideologically. That could make for some clashes between council and the mayor's office. So on that note, let's bring in our line opinion panel for their thoughts coming out of Election Day. Want to welcome in former House Minority Whip Dan Foley, who's back with us. Also, Inez Russell Gomez, editorial page editor at the Santa Fe, New Mexican. Always great to have her. And Michael Byrd, former president of the American Public Health Association and a regular on our lineup panel. Always got to have Michael as well. Thank you all for being here. Now, we'll get to the races around the state in a moment and touch on the historic turnout we saw, but let's keep it in Albuquerque for a moment. Mayor Keller avoids a runoff, but he takes a hit with the stadium vote, guys, and he's going to have to navigate a more conservative council regardless of how those runoffs end next month. So, Daniel, you're no stranger to dealing with those sorts of power dynamics. How will this impact Mayor Keller's agenda headed into his second term?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think it's interesting that he was so closely tied to the stadium to start, but he did a great job of distancing himself during the election from making them two separate and distinct issues, because there seems to be very little bleed over from the overwhelming defeat of the stadium to the overwhelming victory of Mayor Keller. And I think if we would have had this conversation a year ago, 18 months ago, a lot of people would have said, oh, this is a really tough scenario. I mean, if one goes down, how will it affect the other? But I think it just kind of shows his gravitas as a politician, right? He was all in for the stadium, but as his election started and candidates announced, there was very little that you saw from Mayor Keller about the stadium, right? I mean, he quickly went to, plus, I think he did a very good job of never taking the bait, right? He just talked about the few successes he's had as mayor and just ran with those, right? I mean, he just never answered any questions about why is crime so high? Why is homelessness the way it is? And not only did he not answer questions about it, he did a decent job of putting out ads claiming victories in those very areas that people were trying to attack him on, right?
Yeah.
Crime is horrible in Albuquerque. You'd watch a Mayor Keller deal and he'd say, well, break-ins in left-handed Lithuanians' homes in the Northeast Heights are down this year.
Right.
And people were like, oh, well, okay. So, you know, it's an amazing deal. But I thought it was I'm not surprised that the stadium went down. What is interesting is that the amount of money that was put in for the stadium to pass versus the grassroots for the stadium to fail.
Right.
Other than the Rio Grande Foundation, I don't think you'll find any organized fundraising activity to go out and defeat the stadium. That was a purely grassroots, organic, from the streets. And like we joked before, you know, to see the people in Borelis siding and partnering with the Rio Grande Foundation, that is definitely one of the seven signs of the apocalypse. You know, and I think it's just a sign to politicians, you better be careful. You know, you think you're putting everybody in these boxes, but people will quickly jump out of those boxes and join forces if they feel like you're coming after them. And I think the stadium proved that.
Hey, Michael, you know, the voters rejected it at a wider margin than the polling predicted. Interesting. And do we have consensus now about what the stadium situation is going to be? What's your takeaway from this?
Well, I guess the thing I'm looking at really is, you know, looking at those communities and what are those communities' needs, and they clearly felt like they were not part of the process and they were not part of the conversation, and so I think that may reflect on you know, the mayor and his administration, and really not having the kind of conversations that need to take place with communities and community leadership. You know, to Dan's point, it appears that they rejected it kind of outright. And so I think that it leads me to another point, and that is some of the issues that the city is facing in terms of homelessness and policing. What kind of conversations are really occurring with community leadership the communities in terms of what are your needs and what are we doing, and also maybe more importantly, what are we not doing to work with you? And I think that you know that I think there's a conversation, a deeper conversation that is needed with community leadership.
That's right. That's a good point. Hey, Inez, let's bounce up to Santa Fe, of course. The Santa Fe mayor race was very interesting. Alan Weber avoided that 50% or below threshold. Joanne Vigil-Coppler couldn't get it done. Alexis Martinez-Johnson with 10% as well. I got a question, though. What won it for him? I'm just very curious. We've been hearing his COVID-19 pandemic response. People trusted him with a second term. How much of that factored in your view?
I think that was it. I actually think the mask mandate vote is mm-hmm. what did it more than anything, because even though Joanne Vigil-Coppler, when she was on the city council, had very solid reasons that it wasn't as well written, the mandate ordinance wasn't as well written as it should be. Mm-hmm. It was unfairly bringing police in to write tickets, and it wasn't going to be enforceable, and why have a law if it was enforceable? The fact that when she voted against it, she said absolutely not. Mm. Was just fodder for, advertisements that were true. Mm-hmm. If you took the time and looked at the entire council meeting and the series of meetings leading up to the vote, you could understand her vote in context. But at the moment where the pandemic was at its height, where people needed to get behind the governor's public health order, the mayor introduced it, he passed it, and he made the case that it wasn't enough just to go along with what the governor was doing, that we had to have our own statement. And she didn't understand that. Mm-hmm. And I think people in the community realize that when you have a crisis, you want a leader who gets it mm-hmm. in that moment. Even if the solution isn't perfect, you go for it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Daniel, election day, of course, with a hyper-local focus that didn't stop voters from surging to the polls. It was interesting. Berlioz County breaking a record for turnout, more than 30%, as we all know, for an off year. Was it the stadium? Was it other things? What was going on here to get so many folks?
Yeah, I think it's an interesting combination. I was just thinking, as we're talking about this, it's interesting to see Mayor Keller have done so well in the reelection and yet incumbent city councilors do so poorly. So I think it clearly it clearly indicates that the people blame the city council mm. for the situations we're in Albuquerque, not the mayor mm-hmm. per se, which mm-hmm. to me says the mayor did a good job of presenting it that way, right? I mean, making himself look at, the reality is we have a lot of problems in Albuquerque. There's mm-hmm. no doubt about it.
Yep.
And, the voters are not, they're not idiots. They know these problems exist. And so, what I think is the mayor did a great job of saying, look, I'm really not the root cause of these problems. He didn't blame anybody. I'm not saying he said that. He just said, look, if there's nothing to see here, I'm doing the best I can do, which I think left everybody else to say, well, if it's not his fault,
right,
it's got to be somebody's fault. And you're seeing it in the outcome in the elections, because it's interesting. It's yep. going to be interesting to see how long it lasts.
Let me ask you this. You just hit on something there. Dan Lewis, particularly getting back in the game, I got to think that's going to be a pain in a lot of different parts of the Mayor Keller's body here. I mean, does he have an agenda of his own?
So your former opponent, the first time you ran for mayor in a highly contested mayoral yep. race, is now going to be probably the leader, potentially the leader of the city council in a short amount of time.
That's right.
He potentially has the ability to be the leader in title. He's clearly, with his experience, going to be the leader at least at minimum behind the scenes. And if people think Dan Lewis ran without a little bone to grind with Tim Keller, I'm not sure as the mayor that I'd want to have Dan Lewis mm-hmm. in there with his gravitas, having run for mayor, having run for higher office, having been in the spotlight. I think you're going to see some interesting dynamic changes at City Hall and within the city council, especially if the Republicans can pick up one or two of these runoff seats. Mm-hmm. They pick up all the runoff seats. It's going to be mayhem in Albuquerque. I mean, you're going to have a conservative council and yep. a progressive mayor, yep. zero chance of anything happening. If they win one of them, it's going to be interesting to see how people can come together and govern together, because you're going to have a center-right
That's
city
right.
council then
That's right.
with a progressive mayor, and it's going to be interesting to see how Dan Lewis, who I think has the gravitas and the ability to step forward in that leadership role to really get done what he wants to get done, mm-hmm. in way becoming the de facto mayor, right, with the city
That's
council
right.
vote
That's right.
getting his
Hey, Michael, got to get in school boards. Why was there so much interest in these school board races?
Well, given the history of challenges in terms of Albuquerque school board specifically, mm-hmm. I think that, it's clear that that there had been some issues, and I think there's heightened interest in moving us forward, and those issues need to be addressed. Mm-hmm. And I think that's increased the interest and turnout and activity that's taken place.
Yeah, good stuff there. Outside money came in strong for some of the candidates that won. A very interesting turn of events, as Dan mentioned, about the philosophical bent of our school board now. But as they say, it's on to the midterms. Thank you all for your thoughts on this week's vote. Before we move on to other topics on election day, I did have the chance to talk with Mayor Keller and the city's First Lady, Elizabeth. Part of our conversation focused on the impacts of this campaign on what, at that point, wasn't a guaranteed second term.